Well, we're excited to see a full house today. My name is Allison Donta-Venman. I am the chair of your planning and design committee. And these are members of the committee here. We will have introductions later in the conversation. And this is our librarian, for those of you who don't know, Patrick Barrizo. And this is our architect. This is Stu Roberts from Johnson Roberts Architects in Somerville. And they are working with us, and they're going to show you some of the preliminary site work, site designs that we have for you tonight. But first, my job is to tell you a little bit about the process so far and to show you sort of how we got to this position. Your committee has been really working hard for about a year. We did get a grant from the town, from the state, which was matched by the town to do this work. So really, this is not our opinion of what should happen. This is sort of our research as to what we've uncovered, and we really want your opinion as to what you think the best direction for the town should be. You know, we spent sort of all last meeting really talking this through and what the slides would be and, you know, how we could present this information in the most clear way possible. Anyone who wants minutes from our last meeting, we brought some copies. As well as copies of our building program, which we'll refer to. So we are going to present to you what we hope is the most clear presentation, but we know there will be questions, and there's going to be plenty of time for questions afterwards. Can you slide me? Thank you. Can everybody see that? Mm-hmm. Looks, of course,
now. Microphone for me, please.
This microphone?
Yes.
Or this one?
That's fine, there.
This one's fine? Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks. So as I mentioned, we did receive a grant from the Municipal Buildings Committee in spring of 2014, so that was approved by town meeting. I see some of you kind of squinting. Do we need to turn off the lights on this? No?
Is a pedestal possible?
Maybe.
I'll have it up here for the most part.
Can we do this?
On the table there.
Oh, that's great.
Yes? Okay. Sorry.
Also, we could put the table on the table. Put it on the table.
I saw some squinting. I know, it's true. So we've been working under this grant, and we've been working with the architect to produce the design. They will produce designs for an actual building once we've chosen the site, and that's primarily what we're here to talk about today. Sorry, it's hard for you to see. I know. So these are the processes that we've gone through so far. The first step was the writing of the building program. This is really a needs assessment of the current building and what the town needs for a town of this size and in a modern library. And we did comparisons with similar towns. We looked at library use statistics for our own library, for our neighboring towns. And we looked at the population projections for the town. And so then we apply these to all basically standard algorithms from library professionals that really tell you how much space you should have for materials for different programs based on your population size, your usage, that type of thing. And we'll be showing you all of this information. So we did also collect information from the community through surveys and through public forums that we held back last winter. So just going to show you some of the results of our analysis. If you want more, you can't get enough of the slides, there's more in the building program. This is our population projection for Hadley. As you can see, when the library was built in 1902, the population was just under 1,800, and we still are in that same library today. So our library for our population in 2030 is projected to be 5,600. So we are seeing some population growth, but not a huge amount. You can see there's a little breakdown of the age groups. The largest growth is projected to be in older adults. So this 5,600 is what I used for all the calculations going forward. Just a little word on that. We also serve non-Hadley residents in our library, and so our service catchment area is larger than our own population, but to be as conservative as we possibly could, that's the number we use when doing these calculations. So really everything you're seeing tonight is really the most conservative estimate. So we just wanted to give you a little comparison of our library with the towns that are of similar size to us in Western Mass. You can see the list there. And really, we have the oldest building that has not been truly renovated of all of our peers. We did have a renovation in 1920. It was essentially the addition of the memorial wall on the second floor and the little bump out right there. And that's it. It did not affect any sort of space used for snacks. So here is how we rank among our comparative communities. On the population side, we ranked 8th of those communities that I showed you. So now what I did is I took all the publicly available data for libraries in Massachusetts and compared ourselves to all of those other communities. So it's really easy to kind of scroll down. Red is not good, green is good, and you can see how we compare. So we rank amongst the worst rank for gross square footage, dedicating parking spaces. Any of you who are looking for parking in the center of town, I'm sure that doesn't surprise you. And our seating capacity. Our staffing is not that bad. In fact, we have the highest MLS, qualified librarians per population. Our building, the total holdings and holdings per capita is amongst the lowest ranked, as well as the visitors. A word about the municipal expenditures. We rank right where we would expect to rank. In Massachusetts, in order to receive money from the state, each town is required to spend a certain proportion of their budget every year on materials. So in general, all the towns in Massachusetts that do receive money from the state are about the same proportionally, because it is a requirement. Here's just a few more statistics. So we're looking at our circulation now. Again, we're seeing a lot of red, interlibrary loans to and from other libraries. The hours open, again, lower ranked, except for evening hours and weekend hours, the proportion, and the number of programs that we do is also on the lower end. Almost all of this can boil down to the relative space that we have to work in compared to some of our other libraries. So if we have fewer holdings, you can only fit a certain number of books in any given library. So if our physical space is not large enough, we're not going to have as many holdings, we're not going to be able to hold as many programs. We couldn't meet in the library tonight because there is no place to meet that would hold this many people. So a lot of this has to do with the actual space that we have. So this is just some data on how our circulation has changed over time. We did begin circulating through CWMARS in January 2011, and that's just where you can kind of see the line go straight up. This is our total circulation. It's broken down by books, video, audio. So you can see that books are still actually alive and kicking at the Goodwin, and our circulation is growing rapidly. This is just a comparison that we did as trustees. Actually, we started this comparison even before the planning and design process when we were doing our long-range planning, and we went out with a first community survey and asked sort of what could we do better, and the number one thing everybody said is we want more hours. So we really put our heads together, and we came up with a way to offer 8 more hours a week by switching around staffing without any additional cost. And so we really started looking at to see, well, are people really coming? And as you can see, yes, this is the number of patrons per month. The dark green is 2014. We did start the new hours in February of that year. And so for every month after that, we did see an increase. So then we went out with our second survey as part of the planning and design process, and we asked everybody quite a few questions about the library, including this question. How important is the library to you? And as you can see, 76% of the town says it is important or very important to them. So it's a worthwhile project. So this is our current status. And then remember when I told you there were sort of algorithms, you could punch all those numbers in and it would tell you sort of what you should need. This is the slide that shows that. So this is what we currently have. We currently have a staff of 2.7 FTE. For basic needs for a population our size, they would suggest we'd have 5.1 staff. print volumes, we have about 16,000. They suggest 33,000. So if you kind of scroll down the line, except for video recordings are very popular in Hadley, so our librarians have responded by increasing our video collection, which is great. I hear some chuckles in the audience, so obviously you guys are some of the users. And as far as our materials expenditures as well, again, I sort of talked about that, how we really are required to hold the line on that. So we're definitely meeting basic needs, but only basic. We haven't even made it to moderate. So this is really what we would expect to have, one of these things. So obviously it would be great to be excellent, but we're pretty realistic about the size of the town and the building needs that we already have in town. Again, if anyone wants any more of these details, all of these charts are in our building program. So one of the things that we asked in the survey was how important would it be for a library of the future to offer large public meeting space? So we wouldn't all be crammed in the second floor of town hall, sweating it out, struggling with technology, trying to get a meeting happen. And so you said it was important. So the majority of you said that was important. And we asked you how likely would you be to use it. So it will, fewer people said they'd be likely to use it, but they said it was important to have it. Go ahead, thanks. So our, as we said, our current meeting space, we can only accommodate 30 people. And it the first floor of the library is handicapped accessible, but if anybody wanted to actually use the bathroom, the lower floor is not handicapped accessible. So it's really not the ideal space, even if you have fewer than 30 people for a meeting. And right now, a meeting can only occur during library hours. And usually, for any of you who have been there, when there's any library program happening, it's very disruptive to library services because the meetings have to happen really right there out in the floor. Great to have people in the library, but if you're not expecting it, you're coming in to have a little quiet library time, might not be that exciting for you. So if you have it after hours, it does require a member of the staff to be paid overtime to close the library up. Our current facility cannot even accommodate our summer reading program, which is one of the biggest children's programs that we offer. So we have to find other slots, go outside, maybe use the senior center, combine it. So if we can't even offer our own programming, let alone any value added to the town. So based on all of this, what do we actually need? How much space do we actually need? So you saw that basic, excellent, etc. So if you just take basic, you plug those numbers in, then there's sort of another calculation. How crammed in do you want to get? So do you want to be in first class? Do you want to be in coach? We're all sitting in coach here, and what you're going to see tonight is the presentation for coach. So that is that we have the minimum amount of space for the library and the maximum density. All of this to say is, you know, how many, you know, square inches for each book should you allocate, etc. Again, we really were going for the most conservative because if you see the number at the bottom, 11,336 square feet, it's a significantly larger library than we have now. We're only using about 3,200 square feet right now. So this is a significantly larger square footage than we would need just to meet our basic needs for the lowest population estimate and really crammed in like you guys are books. Another thing that we got from the survey is how important the town wanted the library to remain in the center of town. Almost everybody said it is very important that it remains in the center of town. A large number also said that it's important that it remain in the same building. So some of the things you're going to see tonight, all of the things you see, retain the library in the center of town. We felt that was important. That was overwhelming. We did not even look anywhere outside the center of town for a site. And we have also showed all the options that would be at all possible with our current building, and you'll see them. So again, these are some of the statistics that I had. And the questions we really have that we want you to think about as we go forward is, does staying in the same building mean staying within the same footprint of the building? And should we stay in the same building if we're unable to meet the needs for space and collections. So these are some things that we want everybody to think about as we go through. Because now I turn you over to Stu.
Thanks. I'm gonna just slide this over a little bit so I can stand in front.
I know, we're gonna have to look up there.
Is that good? Can everybody see? Is that a good kind of angle? I'm trying to get it so as many people can see as possible. Just to explain where we are, we've been working over the last few months looking at different sites for where the library might go in town. So what you're going to see tonight is kind of the summary of our analysis looking at the sites. Now, as we've done this, we've also come up with some conceptual floor plans for how it might work on each of the sites. And I would tell you that I think as the designs develop, probably a final floor plan at any one of these sites is going to be a little different than what you're going to see tonight. But we've done the floor plans to really test the viability of the various sites so we could see how well each one of the options would function. So when we start the process, the starting point for us in looking at options for how to meet the library needs, it's the building program. So this is the summary of the building program that was produced. There are a couple of numbers that are used in building program. One is net square footage and gross square footage. Let me just explain the difference. Really, the net square footage is all the space that you want to have inside. So that would be how big does the children's department need to be, how big does the meeting room need to be, all of the kind of functional spaces. And if we total those up, that's about 8,500 square feet. Then there's another factor that gets put on, a kind of multiplier, and that's called unassigned space. And that doesn't mean wasted space, it means space that you need to accommodate the things that are inside the building. So that's the thickness of walls, it's stairs, it's elevators if you have an elevator, it's mechanical rooms, it's toilet rooms, it's the other kinds of things that need to go in the building. And there was a factor in the building program, there's a factor of 25% which was put on, which brings the total up to that 11,300 square foot number. Now that 25% is a good number to use, especially for a new building, and that's about what you need. There are some kinds of renovations that we'll look about, and some of the options we'll look at where that is that unassignable space will be a little bit larger in some of the other schemes that we'll take a look at. We start. And we do a numerical analysis, and we also do kind of a graphic analysis over here. So this is we've taken all the numbers in terms of square footage for what should be included in the library and the kinds of things we want to have in each one of those spaces, and we've drawn them up to scale. So just to kind of explain them a little bit, coming in, there's an entrance lobby, there's a circulation desk, probably right behind the desk. You want to have a staff workspace, and that's got a workplace for three people. We also have a director's office, a staff room, and a friends room, so the friends can do their book sale things. So those are kind of what I would term sort of the back of house functions. We also have a meeting room, and associated with the meeting room, there's a little kitchenette. And a storage room. So this is seen as really a kind of flexible room that could be set up with tables or chairs or rearranged in different ways. It's not like an auditorium with fixed seating. So that's why we have that storage room as well. There are toilet rooms and they're associated with that. And we're trying to work it out so that we can make that work after hours when the library's closed so that the community can have as much use of that meeting room as possible. Then coming in, we have this is a kind of the area that would be required for book stacks. We have a periodical reading area, computer study area, new books, audio visual, a little quiet study room, local history room, and then this is the children's department. So there's children's services with younger kids' books, older kids' books, some computers, a service desk, an office for the children's librarian staff, and an activity room for kids so that they can have their own programs within the library. So those are all the pieces that we're trying to accommodate in that square footage for the building.
But not arranged as such.
Right. Not arranged as such. This is, and each one of the schemes we will show you has a different kind of arrangement because depending on the site. So that's one of the key things. But I wanted everybody to understand all the pieces that we're playing with.
It's like Tetris.
So the sites that we looked at, because the feedback was that it really should be in the center of town, we've really only looked at options for the center of town. So we've looked at the possibility of the Hooker School site, you'll see using the building and also maybe replacing the building. We've looked at the possibility of a new library, which might be located behind the Hooker School. We've looked at reusing the existing library by doing additions and renovations. And we took a look at the Russell School as well. So those are the options that you're going to see. And a couple of these will have multiple options. So I think we've tried to do everything we could reasonably think of, and maybe we've even pushed that a little bit far. But I want to show you each of those options kind of quickly. They're conceptual diagrams for how we might handle that. So the first one we'll take a look at is the Russell School. So kind of the issues with the site, it's a centrally located site. I think it's got great visibility, which I think is important. It's nice to be able to know that the library's there, that there are things going on at the library. I think it works well. The site seems to be large enough that it's going to accommodate the library program and parking for the building. The building is a gorgeous building. It's historically significant, I think. It's three floors. Now, we'll talk a little bit about the three-floor issue. That can be a little bit of an issue for libraries. For a library this size, probably the most efficient thing is to have it all on one floor because it's easy for staff to operate. So the more floors we have, there are implications that you might need more staff so that you have somebody to cover each floor and monitor the floors and know what's going on. So this one is three floors, so that's an issue. Each of the floor, it's about 4,000 square feet per floor, so it's about a little over 12,000 square feet total. So it's size-wise, its gross size is good. One of the issues with this is it probably does not have the structural capacity to carry book stack loading. Right? Because we need 150-pound live load because books are heavy. This has probably got something more like 100 is our guess and what would be typical kind of for a building of this era of that size. So that's a little bit of an issue. And as we look at the inside, it's kind of cut up in a bunch of classrooms, whereas a library would really like to be a number of kind of larger spaces. So those are the things that we kind of have to deal with. Yeah, this is an awfully light slide, but the issue here that I wanted to point out is these are the plans of the three levels of the school, and I've taken and highlighted in yellow the areas that would be what you'd kind of call that non-assigned space, because if you look at this building, a lot of the building is stairs and elevators and corridors because it was set up to be a school. So this is the basement level. There's a room in the back. The rest of this is all mechanical and corridors and stairs. The main level, if you came up the steps and came in, there's a large hallway, stairs, and two classrooms, and then upstairs, kind of a similar plan with a couple more rooms. So the issue, one of the issues here is that probably only about 50% of the floor plate here is really usable for those kinds of library functions that we'd like to fit in. It's also cut up in a number of rooms and it's on a number of floors, so getting those kind of large open spaces are a little bit more of a challenge in this building than in some of the others. So we did our best to lay out how a plan might work in this building. So this is kind of the plan. Here is the original building. We need to do an addition onto the side of it, which would be almost as big as the original building in order to accommodate the program. And that's because we're losing so much space in the original building. But this one's set up, I think I even have this color code. Mm-hmm. Do I? Yeah. So kind of these are the functional areas. So on that main level, we have to be able to get in, you know, so to make it handicapped accessible. So the idea is we're going to come into the addition, and there's an elevator, and you could get on the back side of the elevator, go up a half level, and get off at the upper level, and you'd be on a floor that would align with the floor of the original library. Or you could come in and go up a few steps. We've located a circulation desk, kind of so that it can monitor the entrance. We put the book stacks in the new addition, because we can build the new addition so that it can support books. Then we take the original building, we have new books, we do audiovisual, and we do reading areas back here with a workroom in the middle, quiet study and local history. Okay, so this floor is it's the bulk of the adult services kind of functions. So we go up to the next level, this would be the top level. We've taken the addition and we have You could take the elevator on up, right, so you can have elevator access. You could take the stairs from the original building up. Up here we have the children's department, which is in yellow, so that's mainly, we're using the whole floor of the original building. We have a youth workroom, young adults room, the directors, some toilet rooms up in here, staff lounge, friends room. So this is kind of the rest of the functions plus the children's department. And then down on the lower level, the idea would be to take and do the multipurpose room and the main toilets for the building down on the lower level. One advantage of doing this is that means that you could get in and do that after hours. But the rest of the building is all mechanical space. So as we look at this one, I think this one is probably likely to be one of the most expensive ones, because in addition to the renovation of the existing building, we have to do a pretty sizable addition. So this one ends up being about the largest one, so that of the renovations, there's about 12,000 some square feet that we'd have to renovate, but we'd have to do an addition of 8,800 square feet. So it's about 21,000 square feet total, and that's because of the stairs and corridors in the building. So we think that this is probably, of the schemes we're going to show you tonight, this is probably the most expensive one. It also has three levels, so it's potentially that some of the staffing costs could be a little higher. There is a little bit of a floodplain area over here, which I'll mention, too. That's why we kept the additions out off of that side of the site. Energy efficiency, we can make the new addition pretty efficient, but we're hooking it onto an older building, and it's going to be harder to make that completely efficient. So it's kind of a mixed bag in terms of energy efficiency. It will need an elevator, so elevator maintenance and everything is also an issue. And it means that you'd be leaving the current library as well. So we need to find some of the use for the current building. So those are kind of the cons. You know, the pro is, I think, is a good site. The library doesn't have to relocate, so that will be an issue with some of these schemes. In this case, we come over here, do the renovations, and the library can just move in, as opposed to if we were renovating the original library, they'd have to move out during construction. So that's a little bit of a plus here. It does have easy access to the high school. It's taking a vacant building in town and preserving it and putting a good use to it, and I think it's got good visibility. The biggest challenge with this one is probably the size and the cost that we're going to have with this scheme. Okay, so the next one we looked at was additions to the existing building. So the existing building, you know, everybody knows that they love it. That's the library. That's what everybody thinks of. So that's, I think, a plus to keeping the library here. And it's got great visibility. The challenge here is that it's a small building. It's only a fraction of what we need for a functioning library to meet the library needs. And again, it's three floors, but overall, the existing building's only about a little over 5,000 square feet, and we need to have about, you know, 11 some, maybe a little more even in the scheme. So it gets to be an addition that's probably a little bit bigger than the size of the original building. So we looked at doing an addition which would come out to the front. One of the issues with this building is the site is so constrained. There's really no place to go. The property line really comes right back here. So if we stay in the building and only stay on what's the library site, there's really no other place to go than to go in the front of the building. And that even is going to take out most of the parking that's back here. We'll probably still end up with maybe three spaces back in here. Site's just tight. Now, one of the concerns I would have about this one is that in taking a nice old building and putting a big addition on the corner in the front, I'm afraid we may have lost most of what we like about the original building. There's a nice kind of setback that's set up as you come up and down the street here, and all the buildings respect that, and this addition would be then sitting out proud of that in front. So that's, I think, probably one of the big challenges with this scheme. This is the floor plan, as everybody's probably familiar with it. There's a basement which has the children's department in it now. There's some stacks in the back. There are two entrances that come into the main stack room. There's a stack room in the back. And then there's the beautiful meeting room upstairs, but because it's not accessible, we're meeting here tonight. So we took a pass at how this might be laid out. And again, this one's three floors, so it means an elevator. It means some of those staffing issues. This is the original library. This is an addition, so you can see the addition is significantly larger than the original building. But in this one, we've set this up so that you would come around, you come in the entrance, the what I'll call the main entrance, but it already has the ramp, so we're already handicapped accessible to get into this level. We take the room that's the kind of current main room of the library and do the workroom and circulation desk in that. So the circulation desk is right there when you come into the building. Take some of the popular materials, AV and new books maybe, and scatter them around, and take local history and put it back in the back room in the back that has the fireplace. Seems like a good fit there. Then you come on through to the addition. The addition's got an elevator which is located here. We need to do a new egress stair on the building because these stairs don't are not going to come close to meeting the building code. So we have an egress stair back here. This is set up. We have the director, we have young adults, we have adult stacks here. Now in this case, because the floor plate wasn't big enough, I had to take the book stacks and split them into two. So in this case, we have fiction stacks down, new books, kind of popular materials, and then you go upstairs for the rest of the adult services. So this one means you have to split adult services, which is even another little bit of a challenge. Now, you come upstairs, and we take what is the meeting room. It's a gorgeous meeting room. It's a little bit bigger than what the program calls for, but it makes sense to reuse that as the meeting room. So this becomes the multipurpose program room. We build out a little bit in the back here to solve one of the code issues with the stairs, but it also gives us a kitchenette and a storage room back in here. So you could take the stairs up here. You could also take these stairs up. There's an elevator that would bring you up to the upper floor. And so we have the nonfiction collection reference, and we've got a reference desk up here because we need to have a staff position up here now. There's quiet study. There's the toilet rooms, which work to serve the meeting rooms up on the upper floor. And then the lower level is really children's and mechanical spaces. So the children's department would be in the lower level of the addition. There's the youth workroom, we've got staff lounge, the friends room, custodial mechanical, toilets, stairs. Okay? So it's possible. The kind of the cons, I mean, I think the big one is I feel like this one, you know, it's a beautiful building, and I feel like after this is done, we're going to lose some of what's nice about the original building. Because the addition is to the front, it's on the corner, and it's going to be bigger than the original building in order to accommodate the program. It's got three levels. There's no parking on site anymore. Well, I say there's none. There's three spaces that we have left. Again, we have the same issue with it's kind of a mixed bag energy efficiency-wise. We can have an efficient new building, but we still have the original building. It's got an elevator, so there's the maintenance issue. Well, you would have to relocate during construction. We're doing enough work here, you couldn't stay in the building. You'd have to find a temporary library to go into. And when we're done, if you had to expand the library again in 50 years or 100 years, there's no place to go. You've really used up the whole site at that point. The pluses, I think, are it does keep the existing building. It keeps the library in the existing building. It's the same site. It's got good visibility. Overall, we're at about 15,000 square feet here instead of the 11,300, and that's because we have 5,000 square feet, then we have to build about 10,300 to accommodate the addition. And that factor is a little bit higher, as you can probably tell from the diagrams, because I have to have stairs and elevators on three floors, and those eat up a lot of space. So that's why we have more what I would call non-assigned space in this than we do in some of the other schemes. But it's possible. Okay, so we were trying to think of, you know, everything we could possibly think of. So the next thing we thought of was, what happens if we were to take the library and hook it up to the front part of the Hooker School and do a link that would link the two things together? If when you look at it, the floor levels look like they're close, they're probably not exact, we'd have to make some adjustments. This is one, however, I have to say we got into it and we found this one just doesn't work at all. I can't get a plan to work. The only floors that'll support book stacks would be the basement levels. And instead of getting one big space to accommodate those library functions, I now have two over here and one over here. I just don't have enough spaces. So this was kind of at a high altitude, looked like a good concept. And when we got into the details, it really just didn't work at all. Okay. So, brings us to the next one. This is basically, it's to tear down the Hooker School and do an addition to the library. Now, the advantage of that is that the problem with the addition I showed you before is that there's just not enough room on the site to really do a great addition. If we took the Hooker School down, it means that we now have site that's available over here. The property line is really, it's coming right back about, right about there. So we kind of have to build it around in order to accommodate that. But from a diagram point of view, kind of here's what we did. Now this one's a little smaller, right, than some of the others. So there's the original building right down in here. And this is the addition. Now this is a case, again, where we have a big addition and we have the little original building. And the original building has three levels. So the big question in this one was how to effectively use the original library and how to use it. And it's probably the most efficient way to do the addition would be to do it at grade. So we can get right in, there's good handicapped access, but that's not how they built the original library, right? It's up about 4 feet above grade and 4 feet below, and there's another floor above that. So we had to deal with all of these issues and the site issues. And we came up with a plan I think works reasonably well. The idea would be that you'd come in kind of down the drive where you come in on the back side. There'd be an addition, or an entrance that would come into the addition. Circulation desk is located right by the entrance where it should be, with a workroom behind it, director. You come into here, this is young adults. This is periodicals and reference. There's new books up in here. This is the reference computing, and those are the adult stacks in the back. This is set up so that we could use the upper level of the original library as a meeting room, right? So to do that, we have to get an elevator in, we have to get an egress stair. So this is set up so that, because we'd like to, or however we do this, for you to be able to use the meeting room after hours. So this is set up so there could be another couple of entrances that would bring you in, and we could close a set of doors and lock them here, and you'd have access to the meeting room on the upper floor, and you'd have access to the toilet rooms as well. We put local history also in the original library, but it gives us another piece that we're not quite sure what to do with on the first floor, and another piece on the bottom that we're not quite sure what to do with. So as we developed this one, this kind of ended up more as kind of most of the library in the addition and whatever we could come up with as functions to put into the original library. And part of that's just because the floor plates are small in the original building. So that's just a little closer view of the addition, right? So the pros and cons of this one, the cons, I think we end up kind of with a library that's mostly over here, and then there's a little kind of link, and there are a few rooms over on the other side. So I didn't feel like, because of the site, that we got the existing library and the addition as well integrated as I think would be ideal. This is likely to be a little bit expensive. This one's probably about the same size as the other one. It's a $14,705 because we're building about 9,500 square feet new and we're renovating 5,200 square feet. So this is a little bit bigger than the program again because of the addition. Those are kind of the main issues. I mean, the plus is it keeps the building. We don't have to destroy the architecture of the building in the scheme, right? So we're going to do an addition that's next to it. And I think it's probably the most practical way to think about using the original library building of the schemes that we have anyway. A little bit larger than what would be maybe ideal. Okay, so then we looked at the Hooker School, and you know, I'm sure you're all familiar with the Hooker School, but it's basically, there are two portions to the Hooker School. There's a building in the front, which is, I don't remember the date on anymore, but it's the older part, and then the newer addition, which was put on the back. Neither of these are going to support book stacks, right? And that's not even doesn't have the capacity even that the Russell School, we think. It is centrally located, and it's got good visibility, so I think that's a plus. It's a big site, so there's plenty of parking. There's a possibility with whatever we do on this site that there's if you build it up front or build it in the back, there's room for other town functions to go there at some point in the future. If you would remove the senior center or something else that would go on, it could kind of develop a campus kind of design. The existing building is larger, is a little bit larger than what we need for the library. The front part is three levels, and it's about 8,500 square feet. The back is two levels, and it's about 12,000 square feet. So it's a bigger building. Again, no possibility of book stacks on the floors in here. So what we looked at here, this is just floor plans. You can see the front of the building and the back of the building, existing floor plans. So the idea that we came up with was basically to keep the front building in this scheme, take the addition off the back, put a one-level new addition, which would be at grade, not half a level down and half a level up, but at grade, so it would be easy to get in, and then try to use as much of the original library as possible. Again, the original school, it's three stories, so there are challenges in how we use all three of those floors. But the scheme that we came up with is basically, here is the original part of the Hooker School. The current addition comes back here, and we really would be replacing that with a one-level addition. In this design, let's see, put the colors on it, but you come in, we have an entrance in the back. Most of the parking would be located back here. You could still come in the drive on either side in this one. You come in, and we have this set up with a circulation desk by the entrance, young adults. This is new books, so an AV, reading periodicals, popular materials. This is reference and computing, the adult stacks, local history, some more study rooms, children's department over on the other side, and quiet study. Then when we come back into the main room, again, we have to make that change in levels. So we did the same trick again where you can come in and get in an elevator, go up a half level and get off. Or you can go up a half level to get up to the level. And we've got the multipurpose program room with the toilets located up on this level. In this one, the lower level would really be mechanical spaces and some of the administrative spaces. I didn't put that plan in. And the upper floor is kind of up for grabs because we don't really have a good library program that we can put in there. So again, this one is also a little bit larger than what the program calls for. This is about 14,000 square feet. There are a couple difficulties with the plan. The bathrooms, it's kind of hard to see in. And that's one thing that when you're doing a public library, it's good to be able to keep an eye on the toilet rooms because they can be a source of mischief. And it's a little hard to monitor those in this one. It does have the multiple levels, which makes the plan a little bit difficult. We can make the new part energy efficient, but the old part is going to be, we can improve it, but it won't be as good as new construction. This will require an elevator. It's a little bit bigger. It does mean leaving the library, right? So we'd be some kind of new use for the library, but it's got great visibility. There's plenty of parking. It would keep the old part of Hooker if that's something that's important to the community. We've got an entrance in the back that's close to parking, and it lends itself to a campus plan if you were going to do something else in the back at some point later on. So it certainly is a possible scheme. Okay, next one is, let's take the whole Hooker School down and do a brand new library. So when we do the brand new library, it's a little easier to plan. Unlike the renovations, because it's new, we can make the spaces the size they're supposed to be, as it's called for in the program, and we can arrange them in a way that's most that functions the best. So we have good sight lines, and we don't have the three levels, so it's probably easier to run, takes fewer people to run it. It's more energy efficient. There's a bunch of pluses that kind of come with new construction. So we took a look at what happens if you take the whole Hooker down and do a new library kind of in this location right over here, be about that size. All right, so there's kind of a site plan for what that might look like. We would, in this case, you probably could continue this through, but we've only done it on one side, do parking in the back. That would be available for something else, and this would be kind of set up as the library. We've set this up with the main entrance coming right in here, and then to give it some presence on the street, there's a big reading room kind of in the back. So when you come by, it's not like the back of the building. We're trying to make it seem like it's the front, show off the activities that would be inside the library. So this is organized, so, right, you come in the entrance. From the entrance, you can get right into the multipurpose program room, so this works after hours. You can come through here and have access to the toilets, so that meeting room works after hours when the library's closed. If you come on in, the children's department is located right here. There's children's, there's the activity room. We're gonna have colors for this one too, don't we? Yeah, does that make it easier? Maybe not. There's the youth work room. Circulation desk is located right here, right by the entrance, so they can see the entrance from the circ desk. They can see pretty much everything that's going on in the library. Work room is located right behind. There's the Friends book sale room, the director's office, staff lounge in the back, and local history. So come to some smaller rooms here. This is really a big open space that comes through, and this is what you'd see as you come by and look at the library. You'd see the activity in the library here. Book stacks are located here on one level, young adults. So it lays out pretty, fairly efficiently. And this one is about 11,300 square feet. So this is about the right size for the program. So the square footage matches the program. Because it's new, we can do something that's energy efficient. It's one level, so the issue with staff on three levels goes away. I think it lends itself well to a kind of campus setting. There's no elevator. You can stay in the library while this is built, right? We build this and the library can move over. So no temporary library. I think it's got good visibility. It's actually, I think, probably the lowest cost of the schemes we've looked at so far because it's 11,300 square feet, right? Most of the other schemes we were building 8 or 10,000 square feet and renovating 4 or 5. So this one's probably gonna be less money than the others. The cons are, well, you're gonna leave the existing library that everybody loves, and you're gonna have to tear down the Hooker School to make this work. The last scheme is really very similar, but the idea is we put and leave the Hooker School and put the library in the back. So the diagram we have here is really, it's the same diagram, just kind of flipped over. The real difference here, I think, between the two is it's a loss of visibility when you put the library back here instead of having it up front where it's more visible and people see it and know about the library and can see that something's going on tonight at the library. It's a little bit more hidden in the back, so that's a little bit of a problem. But other than that, it's very, very similar, same kind of plan, right? Those same kind of pros and cons, probably about the same cost. This one, the other one, we have to demolish a building, so we'd save the demolition costs, but because it's located back on the site, some of our site development costs would be a little bit more. So my guess is they're gonna be kind of similar costs for those two schemes. So if I take them all and kind of put what I think are the pros and cons, this is kind of how it comes out. Now, I can tell you what the pros and cons are. I can't tell you what the right thing is for your community. That's for you to decide. But I can tell you what the pros and cons are of different approaches and kind of what the relative costs might be. So as we look at the Russell School, I think it's a feasible scheme. I think we have a scheme that works, but it's gonna be about 21,000 square feet versus like the 11,300 that the building program calls for. It's three levels, so it'll have the issues of staffing with three levels. It's got an elevator. Energy efficiency, it's going to be kind of a mixed bag. It doesn't require any demolition, right? It reserves a building in town. You don't have to have a temporary library, so there's only one move, and I think it's got great visibility. So it's got some pluses and some challenges. This is the Goodwin, this is the addition on site, so this is the one that would come out front. So probably I think one of the biggest cons for me for that one is kind of having to put an addition out in front of what's the nice old building. This one's a little bit more reasonable size. This is 15,600, still a little bit larger. One of the disadvantages is there's no parking on site. I mean, there's sort of parking adjacent, but there's no parking really close to the building, except for those three spots that we were able to keep. You would need an elevator. I think the functionality works, it's okay. The energy efficiency would be about like any of the renovations and additions that we have. A plus, I think, is that it keeps the library as the library. No demolition is required. The library would have to move out, so we'd have to find a temporary library during construction because we'd be tearing the building apart. So there are two moves, but the visibility is good. It's great for them. The link, I just put not feasible because we couldn't make it work. Now, the addition, so this is the one where we tear the hooker down and do an addition that goes off the side. This one's a little bit more efficient, so that's about $14,750. The parking, it's a little bit remote in that one. If you notice the plan, we just don't have so much parking. We have a little bit of parking by the front door, but most of it would be kind of back around to the back. It has the issue that it's three stories, although we're not really putting library functions in the three stories. So one of the big questions is, what are we going to put in the original library, and what might those functions be? It does have an elevator. Energy efficiency, it does mean that you have to tear down the hooker school, right? So there's some demolitions that's required. You'd have to move during construction, so there's two moves, but it's got good visibility. The next one's the hooker school with the new addition, right? So this is the one where we had the hooker school and did the addition out the back. In this case, it's about $17,675. So it's one of the bigger ones to do that. I think it's... The parking is good, right? Because there's plenty of room on that side for parking. It is three stories, so we've got an elevator and the issues of staffing, although by putting most of the library functions on one floor, we've kind of mitigated that. You would have to have an elevator. The energy efficiency is going to be a little bit mixed. We'd have to tear down the hooker addition. You could stay in the library, right? You don't have to move out. So we don't have to do that. So there's only one move. And the visibility, I think, is pretty good. And then of the two new ones, they're basically the same. That's whether it's in the front or the back. It's 11,300 square feet. So it's probably the lowest cost one and the most efficient one. Functionality, I think, is pretty good in that one because we can put things where we want. There's no elevator. We can do efficient construction, so it should be energy efficient. It does mean that the library isn't the library anymore, so some other function would need to we need to find a use for the building. And it's because it's new construction adjacent, you don't have to move out of the library when they do the construction. They can just build it and move in. And I think when it's up front, the visibility is very good. I think the con when we put it in the back is that the visibility just isn't so great, and it's a little bit hidden by all the other buildings that are around it. So that's where we are with the options that we're at. As I said, what we're really looking at now is site selection. Which one of these is the right direction to go in? Not so much that the children's department is here, there, and whatnot. It's really kind of more the big picture that we're looking at.
Some of these sites require demolition. That's not free. What kind of cost does that entail?
Cost for demolition is probably less than you think it's going to be. We did the library in South Hadley, and there were two buildings there that we had to take down to do that library. And I think, I want to say that was $50,000 to take those buildings down. So something like that is kind of the kind of numbers that I think you'd see for demolition.
A couple of the early ones you had on the bottom that they weren't available for a grant. So, but at the end, it wasn't mentioned.
Yes, so I did, because that was down at the bottom of the screen, and I couldn't see it very well. So I would just say we kind of put that in as a kind of judgment call. We are looking to get a grant from the MBLC, and so I think we're looking to do something that is going to rise to the top. And probably the ones where we're doing great big renovations to buildings and the functionality is not absolutely perfect are going to be less likely to rate well and go high on that ranking list than some of the others. So that's why I think all the three-story ones are going to lose some points. I think as we put most of the functions on one floor like we did with the addition, to the one floor addition to either the hooker or the original building, it begins to get a little bit better. But those first two, three levels, those I think are going to be problematic. Don't know for sure, but I think they could be for a grant.
I'm sure a topic that came up, I just want to know how it was addressed, is displaced programs. That currently we use that field out and back where a new building would go. That would change a lot of things. Also, we currently use the Hooker School as our senior center.
It's a very bad senior center.
Well, I'm sure, I have no doubt, but maybe they'd be glad to be thrown out. But it isn't free. When you displace the senior center, then it does, even though it may cost less than something else, it increases the cost to the town someplace else. So I just want to know, it's like, yeah, we talked about that. And I feel like there should be a little category where it says, is something displaced? Is there a cost, will there be a cost for a replacement cost for something?
For something that's displaced, yeah.
That's not, there's not a star for that.
So I'll take that one. So we have been working really closely with the Municipal Building Committee.
Yeah.
We do have a member on our committee, David Chevitz is on our committee. We also have a couple other members here today. So some of these questions are gonna be a little bit more detailed than I can answer, and I'm sure that they will have more information. But this, we have been working with them all along to say what is feasible as you look at the entirety of our building stock going into the future.
Yeah.
So you said this is not such a great senior center. You're not the first person to say this, including folks from the senior center. So all along, you know, the Municipal Building Committee has known that they have to put some thinking into the senior center, that we have to put some thinking into what are we going to do with this vacant Russell School,
right,
and all of these buildings that are not accessible. So all of this stuff is sort of being considered as part of the greater whole with the Municipal Building Committee.
And I guess that's what I need to hear from you is, oh yeah, we're not stupid. We didn't just like think it was like nothing. That there is a bigger picture.
There is a bigger picture, and we worked with them, and so when we went to them and said, the town would like us to stay in the center of town, what are our options? And so this is how we ended up with these possible sites to begin with. So at those of you who have been following the conversations with the North Hadley Hall, you know, probably know that they are working on things that would increase our fields for the town. So there's a lot of moving parts, for sure.
I'm just worried about the parade.
I really don't know how it would affect the parade, except that yes, for sure, during construction, if it were not at the Russell School.
If you put that new building in the middle of where I put that rope.
Yes, it would be lots of green space, for sure. So you might want to go to the next slide, because we do have some next steps, and that might help some.
I was ready to vote.
Yeah, I have a couple of comments. In addition to the senior center, that's also the planning department and TV5.
Yep.
So
HCAT
as well.
Thank you. Thank you.
So that magnifies your moving
issues. Right. There's stuff. Like, we might not have to renovate Russell for this.
We had to move over to Russell because we couldn't fit in town hall physically anymore.
So a poor Russell building, what we've got, just gonna have to bite the bullet.
The other part is you're in the Village Center Overlay District. That's in the bylaw, but you'll have to have a peaked roof. There is a limitation on the footprint in the Village Center Overlay District, which I don't recall off the top of my head, but the bylaw is online.
Okay.
And we would certainly expect to see it comply.
Mm-hmm.
That's the whole point of having the Village Center Overlay District.
Allison, can I just address bigger issue? Just from a planning standpoint, and thank you, I think you're right, I think there actually should be a category relative to the, you know, the opportunity cost or whatever you want to call it, or the impact of moving, et cetera. But there's not a chance that an article for the library is going to be put on town meeting floor out of the context of everything else that's going on. So I just want to be very clear, the library is moving forward on a very set schedule because of the
right, that's why I had put up next steps, so you could kind of see why we're having this discussion now, maybe before the town is discussing what should we do with the senior center.
Right. And so what you'll find is everybody in this room will be at the special town meeting at the end of October, so expect to see everybody there. But there will be additional articles relative to the town buildings that are brought to that meeting. Select Board's talking about it with the Municipal Building Committee Wednesday night this week.
Right.
Again, so there's no doubt that the bigger picture has to be laid out for this to make sense. So I just wouldn't want anybody left with the impression, because I've heard this from a couple of people, that the library folks are running off and doing one thing, and then, you know, the other buildings are being discussed. That's not the case. Everything is trying to be dovetailed together so that it's a a clear picture of what all of those ramifications might be and who might move where and when. Don't know the, you know, the answers yet, but that's what's happening right now.
So the next steps was not meant to cut off discussion. It was just sort of meant to contextualize some of these dominoes that were falling into place. So part of the reason for us sort of moving forward quickly is that the Mass Board of Library Commissioners periodically offers grants. So the next grant, the deadline for the grant is January 2016. And those are to be awarded in June 2016. So in order to qualify for this, we are having to go through the process that we're going through now, and we would have to have a grant in by January. So this doesn't mean that everything...
You mean January 2016.
No, she means 16.
16, yep. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't mean that everything has to be decided, you know, but we do have to have a site, we do have to have a design, but let's say, for example, that we, you know, the best design was, you know, linking up with Hooker School. So obviously the town would then have to, we'd have to have conversations about, is this really feasible in light of everything else that you're doing? But this is the timeline that we're on. This is why when people have asked us, why don't you just wait and let the Municipal Building Committee figure out where everything is going and renovate all those other buildings first and then do this? The short answer is because we do not know if and when this grant will ever become available. So we would essentially have to start from scratch all over again. Just to contextualize, the grant is worth really between 25 and 50%, depending on the town, depending on your grant, depending on the money available. For the cost. So we could get, you know, sort of a half price library, for example. This library is also something that other towns have been very successful at private fundraising. So it's likely that the town may only have to pay for a third of the cost of a brand new library in addition to our existing library. In Granby, it was about a third that the taxpayers paid for. So this is why, this is a great opportunity, this is why we're moving forward quickly. But again, sort of not, as Molly said, running off on our own, just coming up with these ideas in a vacuum. This is definitely, you know, been a joint effort with the Municipal Building Committee. There's a question.
A snapping turtle lives a long time in its shell. It's very rugged. It's around. But when I listen to this presentation, I feel like we're trying to attach a new library to an empty snapping turtle shell with all kinds of constraints and all kinds of problems that we're going to be sad about in the future. I really hope that we move in the direction of a completely new library. When you walk into the library in Sunderland or in South Hadley, it's open enough, it's welcoming, it's functional. I think we need to consider form and function and forget the attachment to the discarded snapping turtle shells. As a point for discussion.
Anyone want to snap at that?
Is there any thought, or is it possible to include solar panels on the roof of the new library building?
Absolutely. We have done that, I think, probably 4 or 5 times. And I should mention that we're going for a grant from the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners. In addition to the basic library grant, they have another grant which would give additional money if you can achieve LEED certification. So if we can do that, and solar panels have been a big piece of what we have done on some of our other buildings, and so absolutely, yes, it's possible.
Well, the Sunderland Library has geothermal. They don't even have a furnace.
Yes.
They do not use oil or anything else. It's strictly geothermal.
Right.
They said they've never had a problem.
Yeah, I would like to see some kind of alternative energy included in the plan eventually. Mm-hmm.
So just so you guys know some additional next steps. So right now we're talking about the sites. So we have to figure out what site we're going to be able to use. And after that, then comes the design discussions. And that's exactly, not that we're not thinking about those types of things, but we can promise you at least in one more public forum where we really want to get your ideas about things like that, about design, different locations. As Stu said, these are only just sort of guesses how we fit all of these things in. But it may be that people have very strong feelings about where the young adult room goes as well as solar panels. And that is something that we will be discussing as well.
So I vote for the Hooker School site, and it'd be great if you could keep the Hooker School, but if you can't, just use the Hooker School site. That's what I think. Russell School, no. Existing library, no. New building, no. All right, that's what I think.
Second. In the back.
So it seems to me that all of these sites have a cost to them, right? So are, is there going to be any ballpark costs put to each of these sites before the decision is made?
So I could let our expert answer, and then I will answer sort of where we are in the town on thinking about that.
Yeah, I mean, the first, that's why I bring up the square footages, because at this point, the square footage is going to track very closely with the construction cost. So you can kind of look at the square footages and get a pretty good relative idea of what the costs would be. We will be, when we get into the design, we will be doing a detailed cost for the project, which will identify the construction costs as well as all the other soft costs and all the project costs, and that'll be part of the grant. I'm reluctant to throw out any numbers until we do our due diligence and do the design and have a good solid number that we can put out there. So that's why I'm not... Well, I don't have any numbers to share with you in terms of relative costs, but I would look at the square footage. That'll give you a pretty good indication.
There are
Stu,
figures
do you want to go back
for
to that?
Costs for square footage for renovation and for new construction.
For new construction, sure, there's good rules of thumb
right.
for what it has cost, sure. For renovation, it's going to be all over the place.
Right.
Right.
So what are those figures?
Well, if you looked at South Hadley, let's use South Hadley.
Great.
South Hadley costs about $300 a square foot to build. Okay. Now that was, it's been built, right? We have inflation that's running about 4% per year in the construction industry right now. What year are we going to build this? I don't know yet. So we need to inflate that forward. So it'll cost you something more than $300. I don't know what that's going to be, but that would give you an idea of the construction costs. Renovation costs are really, they're going to be all over the place. They could be any place from $100 to $500 a square foot, just depending on what it is that you're doing. So
if you did 11, 3 times 3, what is that?
Well, I don't want to put a number out because I want to be responsible. So the first number you're going to hear from me is going to be based on something real.
So, and the other cost to keep in mind is that if we went before the MBLC writing a grant for these different ones, each of these would be received in a different way. Mm-hmm. So we may qualify for more money from the state if we have a more favorable design. Mm-hmm. So even if we had two square footages that were exactly the same, and so the cost might look the same on the surface, if the MBLC grants, if they thought, well, this is a great design, we're going to really fund this, it's going to be qualified for LEED certification, we could actually get more money for that, so it could end up costing the town less, even though on first pass it would look like the two are equal. So there's so many factors in here that there's really not much to go on except for the square footage at this point.
And the square footage seems to say the new library is going to be the cheapest possibility as well as the most functional.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So that would be
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think there's another thing to look at that I always focus on, and that is we're building, whether it be the renovation or building a new building, this current library is 120 years old. I would expect that this library is going to be 100 years mm-hmm. before somebody decides they want to do something with it. And that's 100 years of operating costs. And the less expensive the operating costs are, the less overall expense the town is.
Which is also related to the square footage. You have to have fewer square feet.
And running an elevator, there's elevator maintenance costs, yes.
Yeah.
David?
I have a few questions.
Please.
I'd just like to say again how much we appreciate as the Municipal Buildings Committee working with you on this. You've been very proactive, and we're trying to keep up with you. We've, as you know, we've got many buildings, we've got many issues, and we've spent our first year sort of fixing things that have been broken for a very long time. But you're thinking ahead, and that's much appreciated. One of the questions I asked you during our meetings was the trend in digitized media and how that may affect the building program and maybe suggest a smaller square footage. And I know the answer, but I think this group would benefit from that.
Mm-hmm. Patrick, I think that you're probably the person best to take that.
Well, it's difficult to predict what we'll be doing in 20 years, but I think from all available evidence, the more choices we have, it doesn't necessarily lead to less need for space, less programming, less collection space. I think people will still be reading physically, even if they're also reading electronically. I can't really tell you, numbers and how quickly changes will happen. But I don't predict, the demise of print or physical objects anytime soon.
And clearly the state feels the same way, because the state is funding these, and they every few years they have been putting forward these grants, and we are encouraged to, so we're asked to project our population out for 30 years, but we're asked to think about a library that could last for 50 years, and we are all realistic that whatever we do will be here for at least another 100.
I would just point out too, if you looked at the program diagram, the biggest block isn't the book stacks. What we're really building here is it's space for people. Mm-hmm. There are books there, but it's the bulk of it. It's space for people who want to come and use the facilities.
There was a hand in the back. I'm sorry.
Within the last 2 weeks, the New York Times has reported a decline in the sale of digital media, decline in the sale and use of books in digital format. People are turning back to books in print. And that article can be checked.
Especially if you have
papers. Saw that.
You saw that?
Yes, I did.
Great, thank you.
David, you had another question?
I had a question pertaining to the options, and I guess first I should say as the chairman of the Municipal Buildings Committee, we've looked in depth at the Hooker School building, and we can tell you that there's lead and asbestos in that building. The electrical systems are obsolete. The mechanical systems are obsolete. It is not accessible, as you said. There's some water damage. The good news is we have a new roof, so it's going to last for a while without deteriorating to the point where we can't use it for anything. So that is a concern, and I think our committee is intrigued by some scenarios relative to the addition and tearing down Hooker, or building a new facility in the footprint of Hooker School. But I guess I had a question about the parking, because I think that in the tear down Hooker and add to the Goodwin, you say that the parking is remote, but yet the footprint for the new facility is very similar to the addition.
Yes, so. I guess the difference is it's in, at least in this diagram, it's where we put the entrance.
Okay.
And when we did the new building, the entrance is kind of on the back.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't do that in the addition scheme, because if we put it on the back, you got to come all the way through the plan and take a right to get down there. So it's just a lot of corridor space. So we moved the entrance around to the side. So that means that there's some parking on the side that would have close. So there'd be some close parking, but there's also parking that's going to be back out behind the building.
Okay, but I think that's something that could be resolved such that the parking issues are maybe not terrible for the addition.
I want to drive all the way around.
That's just to put an exclamation on that. There's a lot of work needed at Russell School, and the sizes of the spaces within are not favorable for any program that we can think of that this town has at this time. So I'll leave it at that.
I love the Russell School plan. I loved it. It just seems crazy.
Mm-hmm.
I loved it, and it's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious about how these plans scale out over the 50 years or 100 years that we're talking about. What are the implications? What are the possibilities for future use in terms of both the adaptability of the space you're talking about, trying to focus on the use of people as opposed to items, and then also if there should be need for more space, if there's an expansion or anything like that, what are the possibilities
there? Yes, yes. So those are all great questions. First off, as a condition of the grant, when the program was written, the MBLC wants to look at the projection out 20 years, right? So the program is really based on the town's needs for the next 20 years. Now that's, you know, how do you know what you're going to need in 20 years at this point? But that's what that was based on. So, you know, that's why it's the size that it is because it's at least planned for that far out. Beyond that, unlike, let's say, the Russell School, right, which is all load-bearing masonry with big chimneys that come up the middle, and it's not very flexible. Anything that we would build, whether it's wood frame or steel frame or hybrid, is going to be very flexible inside so that it can be reconfigured. We try to plan it as open as possible. So, you know, the first thing is you move some things around, and, you know, if you need fewer books, maybe some book stacks come out and some computers go in. Beyond that, even the walls that are in there would be flexible enough that at some future point, if you needed to expand a children's room or something, it wouldn't be that difficult to do.
Okay.
In terms of then future expansion beyond that, one of the things that the grant will ask for is that when we do the site plan, we at least dot in an area and show them where it can be expanded in the future. So both of the schemes of the Hooker School have room to do that. Russell School's pretty much maxed the site out, and both of the additions that we have to the Goodwin School pretty much max out the sites that are available.
At the Hooker School, does that impinge on parking or green space, or if there were expansions? The expansion at the Hooker School that you're thinking about?
Yeah, so basically the footprint of what we're doing would fit pretty much where the footprint of the Hooker School is currently, unless we do the new scheme in the back, and then that's obviously right. going to impact green space.
Right, but if you built the scheme of the new building in the site of the Hooker School
yeah.
and there were expansion, would there be room for that with parking and green space as it is now?
I think that the new building just about fills out pretty much the footprint of where the existing Hooker School is. So future expansion would push out a little bit. Yeah.
I would encourage you just to take a look at Hooker School with new addition B. It's not there yet. And that would be that the new addition be two-story, since you have to do the elevator anyway, so that the new addition could actually be a smaller footprint, which would have less impact on the drive around and leave more accessibility for parking. So if you're going to do the elevator anyway, just have the addition be two-story. Second story could match second story of the front. You'd still have to have the half stair at the bottom. Anyway, that's what I think, just for consideration.
In the back.
I have a couple questions. So the first, I wanted to make sure I understand the timeline. So your committee will select the site by the end of this calendar year. Is that correct?
Can I?
Please.
Because it's
yep.
17, not 16. So we will, in May, go to town meeting with the suggested site. And we are going to ask for the town's support so that we can go for the grant.
Okay.
In May.
So
we're hoping for the town to support. That is not saying that you're going to fund the library. It says that you as a town are supporting, or we, I'll go for it, are supporting a change to the library. Then in January 2017, we will go for the grant. We will go for the building grant.
I thought the grant application was January 16th.
Yeah, no, Joanne's right.
January 2017, we will go for the grant.
Okay.
When
yeah.
we get to January 2017, we expect we will have raised some money. We are forming a capital campaign. We expect that we hopefully will come get this grant, so 50% will be covered. Part will come from the capital campaign, and a piece will come for the town. After we find out about the grant, the town then has to vote and say, yes, we will put our money towards it. So in May, we are not asking for money. We are asking for support to go for the grant.
Okay.
Does that help?
That does.
Okay.
Thank you. And so then in May, when you present the plan, that will be with like a top choice for the site selection and maybe a backup choice or just the idea of a new library.
It will be a site.
Okay.
And probably, Stu, I think you'll...
Yes, we should have a detailed
yes.
design by
yeah.
then. We will
right.
we will have, so we need to pick a site
mm-hmm.
fairly soon.
Yes.
Right.
So that we can develop a plan to have for the county.
So you're here to tell us what you like.
Right, so yes, we want this information because over the next month at our meetings, that's our job, is to say which of these are, you know, so obviously we have one that we've already really realized the nuts and bolts are not feasible, but now we're trying to take all of this information in. We'll meet with the Municipal Building Committee again and sort of narrow down, these are the sites, because we need to start coming up with designs and thinking about things like, are we gonna have solar? How are we gonna get back to the public? So we will have the site, as Stu said, very soon, and then we will have a series of designs that we will be coming back to the public for.
Okay, so I guess my follow-up question to that is, if you determine that the best site to choose requires demolition of a building in the center of town, at what point will that be presented to the town? And just to play like devil's advocate, how do you anticipate the public's reaction and feeling your way through that? We were probably all at the meeting where they were talking about North Hadley Hall, and that just gets really touchy for people. And so I just wondered what your perceptions of that will look like, when the town will hear about it, know about it.
So as trustees, should I talk a little bit about our plan has been, and we've been asking every board in town, some of you here can testify, can we come to your meeting? Can we tell you what's going on? We have laid out a map where we are attending PTO meetings, Mothers Club meetings, Polish American Club meetings we've asked for. We've asked to talk to the Men's Club. We've asked to talk to the Lions Club. We feel it is our mission between now and May to be out there telling everybody exactly what's going on. So depending on the moment you see us is where we are in the process. But as trustees, that's how we cooperate with the Planning and Design Committee, is to really get word out to the town and listen.
And so to add to that, really if any site other than building on our own footprint is really what rises to the top.
Right.
This really has to be a joint discussion with the Municipal Building Committee.
Right.
Because as the overseers of all of our buildings in town, they're really the ones who have to say, yes, this idea fits with our plan, or no, this idea does not fit with our plan. So it really has to be a joint effort, joint announcement, if you would, about that.
I'll say from a perspective of our Municipal Buildings Committee is that, you know, it's going to become a lively discussion point for the next couple of months. And we have open meetings on Tuesdays. They're televised. Next Tuesday at 7 p.m. in this room is our next meeting. And I would love to encourage all of you to attend and help us make these important decisions.
Just go up. Go 5 stories.
And our next meeting is October 5th in the library. So Library Planning and Design Committee. So, like David, they're public meetings. I would encourage you to come as well. I saw you had your hand up when I started.
No, I was just thinking of all the buildings in the center of town. The least valuable, the ugliest, is Hooker School.
Right.
So if you took that one down, I think you'd probably have fewer people saying,
especially
you know,
the back of Hooker School.
Well, actually the whole thing.
Yeah,
you know?
Right. I'm not that, Jordan went to school there.
Yes.
I'm sorry, with all the dates flying around, I'm still unclear as to when our opportunity is to tell you which site we prefer.
Tonight. You can tell us tonight.
Okay.
So I'm just going to go back to our next steps. I'm also going to show you our website, because we do have a website. Mm-hmm. So you can log in there. There's a comment page. You can come to our meetings. We do post the dates of our meetings on there. So you can look in one place to see where we're going to be. The Municipal Building Committee meetings are posted on the town calendar. So any of these are really an opportunity to give us the feedback about the site. But as Sue said, we're going to need to choose this pretty quickly. So this is going to be the main topic of our discussion, almost our entire discussion of our next meeting on October 5th. So if you still have thoughts that are rattling around in your head, you know, maybe you can't share them now, or you think of something later, that would be a great opportunity. Share on the web with us, that would be great as well. Joanne?
I'm also gonna make the suggestion, or we'll make sure it happens, is that we have a spot in the library where you can, maybe a form or something, you can fill out and put in a box.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen it, this is what I think,
mm-hmm.
so not just online, but physically even come into the library and tell us. I think that would be a good thing to do.
And this is going to be on the TV5, so this will be broadcast. I'm sorry, everybody does it. Anyway, it's going to be on our local TV, and so you'll be able to watch it again, encourage your friends to watch it. We are going to post it on our website so everybody can look through these slides. You won't have the lively discussion on the website, but you will have the slides so you can refer to them. Yes?
I just wanted to say, this reminds me of this young woman's question about what decision you were going to make is, when people say, what are they going to do with the library? And the answer is really, what are we going to do with the library? And I think people have to speak up, because otherwise, five people make the decision and then everybody can complain. So I think it's really important to just put your voice out there, however you do it, in writing, online, whatever.
Well, if a new library is built in another location, then the current library, like, removes itself from deciding what the current library will be, right?
You mean what happens to the physical building?
Yeah.
So then it becomes the job
of the
municipal
town,
building
right.
committee.
Right. It's not you don't get both.
With no addition, yes. Right.
You get to keep the old one too.
Right. So so yes, and that would be a factor. So if we are not going to be using the building, that would be part of the discussion. So what then could the town do with this? Or will this be just yet another vacant building that the town needs to deal with?
Mm-hmm.
So
beautiful.
It is beautiful, and it is the best kept. If you looked at the DRA report, our building is in the best shape. So that's the plus about it. Yes.
There was an issue about the square foot, but footprint, right? Is that the one you raised? And it sounded like that there's a central historic village that has a certain limit.
Yes.
So, but that sounded like it was a surprise to you. So is there some way we can quickly find out to see if these
it's new... It's on the town website.
I'll go check it out.
I mean, if we say we want a new building, and then you go back and say, oops, you know, it's twice whatever that limit is, it sort of negates some of the things we've said here.
I will have to go back and see what it says, because they would affect not just the new building, it would affect all the additions and everything else that we'd be looking at as well. So I'll have to go see what it says. And as to the pitched roofs, I mean, what we have is very conceptual, but I've already got a pitched roof on everything, assuming that that's what we were going to do.
The Hooker Street School is there now, so it's not going to be bigger than the Hooker Street School.
One of them is bigger.
No, the Hooker School. Is there now.
Right.
Yeah. A building is going to be the same size as the Hooker.
It's a little bigger. It's a little bigger.
I'd have to go back and look, but it's about the same.
It's close.
It would definitely affect new construction. If you put in a freestanding building, that would definitely be subject to it. Whether an existing structure, if you were renovating it, that's one thing. If you're absolutely raising it and putting up something else, that may or may not be protected. That's
good. That's a good question.
But it's the town's choice.
Right.
I mean, if we amend the bylaws, so be it.
Would you like, it requires a two-thirds affirmative vote at town meeting to amend the bylaws.
Well, if they're in favor of a larger footprint, they'll amend it.
No, that's not slam dunk.
It's Hadley. Have you ever been down Railroad Street where it says Town Road ends here? And there's the other sign, however.
All good points.
It's the however town.
Any other questions or comments?
I'm going to speak as a resident of town, not as the station manager of HPACT. But have you spoken to the Council on Aging at all about Hooker School?
Yep.
It's actually the Hadley Senior Community Center now.
So yes, so one of our library trustees or two of our library trustees were recently at one of their meetings having the conversation. So I don't know, Alan, if you want to say anything.
Yeah, I met with Suzanne and the Council of Aging Committee and told them about the process and about this meeting and about the possibilities that were out there. And most people knew what was going on. It's the timing of it that, you know, perhaps they weren't fully involved with. But I did have one meeting with them, and we hope to have others.
We've actually been working with them as library trustees for quite a while. As part of our long-range process, we were working a lot with them about their usage, and they asked for some very specific hours for us to open that would fit better with their programming, and that it was one of the things that we did. So we've been trying to work with them because those are some of our biggest users.
Yeah. It's just the way the plans were presented for Oakbrook School. They didn't even acknowledge that it's the senior center. Like it was just an empty building. It's yours to use if you need it. I mean, the seniors have to go somewhere.
Yes, as well as planning
so
board in your office. Exactly. And so that's what some of the comments were, is that it is a whole town-wide discussion if one of these plans replaces another building.
Yeah.
Yes.
I was going to say, putting it behind the Hooker School in the field or whatever, a brand new building, architecturally or whatever, is there ever a way, even if it's not right up front of the town square, to call attention to it? Don't they have signs or some way that would highlight that if you built behind Hooker, if you ran into trouble getting that building?
Yeah, you could certainly have signs. I think it's more, you know, if you lived in town and you went to the library, you're going to know where the library is. So that's not so much the issue. I think it's more an issue that it's good to have the building be visible and have its use be visible so that it's more on the minds of people who live here and that they can see that stuff's going on. That's really the issue, I think. And it's located back on the back there. It's probably going to be pretty hard to do that, just given the fact that we have buildings on, you know, that are blocking almost all the street looking back in.
Any other comments or questions? Yes.
I just have a quick question. So when we decide what the site plan, or what the site for the location for the site of the new library or the renovated library should be, if they decide to do the Hooker Street School, that would then be three plans that would move forward. Is that correct? Because it would be one with the original school and then the one-story addition. Or is what we what we deciding on not just the site but also which?
Yeah, there's one. So we'd take one scheme and develop that, and that one proposal becomes part of the submission to the Massachusetts Board of Library Commissioners.
Well, if anyone has anything else, I encourage you to visit us online or come to our meetings, come to the Municipal Building Committee meetings. We're on the agenda every single time with them. So either place you will hear about it. October 5th is really gonna be the sort of really in-depth conversation amongst your committee here to sort of hash through everything that we've heard, not just here, but through emails that we have already gotten. And feedback that we have in other ways, including in the community survey. Some people were already telling us where they thought the library should be. So we've been collecting this information for over a year. Yes?
I just want to thank the library trustees for all the good planning and outreach you've been doing. Like, I was on the at the meeting of the Historical Commission, and a trustee came in, and we meet in the back part of the old Hooker School. And came to us, and I know you've been going to all these different things, and I think you should be commended for that.
Thank you. Well, thank you for coming tonight. Thank you. Thank you.